One hallmark of humanity is our use of fire. Since time immemorial, we have used it for heat, light, cooking, and more recently manufacturing and many other applications, and have since our advent as Homo sapiens. We did not actually harness fire, however, as it's often put, but inherited the technique of harnessing fire. The actual beginning of hominid fire use actually seems to start with Homo erectus, long before anatomically modern humans came along. Fire is interesting technologically. I often hear in the comments section that SETI must be looking in the wrong place, and that aliens may not use radio for communication, in favor of some other future technology. The problem with that though is that radio is a property of nature, not an invention. It was a discovery. The invention is in coming up with ways to transmit and receive radio signals. But in the end, all we've actually done is harnessed radio just like we did fire. Also a property of nature, but more on that in a bit. It's complicated. In the end, however, harnessing properties of nature actually leads to them being difficult to make obsolete. You work with what you have, and as a result, not only are humans still using fire 400,000 years after it was fully harnessed and habitually used, there are actually more artificially created and sustained fires going on Earth right now than at any other time in human history. It doesn't seem likely that is going to change anytime soon. And it may work that way for radio as well, in that it's too useful to go obsolete, and in certain contexts, such as radar, there's no reason to stop using it because it just does its job. Other than the hominids, no other species on Earth have ever harnessed fire. Strangely, there is at least one species, however, that does use it. They just can't start it from scratch. It's a group of birds in Australia, known collectively as firehawks, and they basically hang around the edges of wildfires and watch for prey fleeing the fire. There are reports, however, of at least one species actually picking up burning grass or sticks in their beaks and dropping them on grasslands to deliberately start wildfires so they can hunt what comes running out. Setting aside the highly unsettling idea that dinosaurs that survived the asteroid and became the birds only then went on to learn to deliberately set fires, the realities of fire actually are quite complicated and actually do represent a viable solution to the Fermi Paradox as far as the development of a technological civilization. But it's weird in that it's actually a double-edged sword in that it also presents a very marked potential biosignature in general that if we ever saw it in a certain context, it would tell us a great deal about an exoplanet biosphere that would give us more clues about what it's actually like on the ground than most other biosignatures would. The first part of the solution to be considered is oceanic life. We know from Earth's oceans that certain physiologies are very good for an aquatic environment and emerge multiple times independently through convergent evolution, such as the shapes of dolphins and sharks, and so on. But also why human civilization shapes its torpedoes in a generally similar manner. Fins and long thin profiles allow for fast movement in water. But that puts most oceanic life at a physiological disadvantage, as far as developing technology and manipulating the environment goes. Fins are not as good as hands in this regard. Obviously, certain species can do this quite well, such as an octopus, which can be highly intelligent and also manipulate its environment. But this becomes more difficult for a shark. It's not easy to envision a shark fashioning a stone tool or an iPhone with its physiology. But there's a bigger problem. To create technology and smelt the metal to do so, you need a lot of heat, and you aren't likely to master fire in a liquid water ocean. If your entire planet is covered in an ocean with no land, it may not matter how intelligent you are. If you have neither the physiology nor the chemical ability to start a fire, then you're extraordinarily limited in what you can do as far as technology. You also need to be able to find and mine ore, so you need geology too. And even if you somehow do get that, you very likely won't be launching rockets full of water and their payloads into orbit. Nor are you likely to ever do much in astronomical observation, as telescopes don't work well on the seafloor, and so on. But the problem doesn't stop there. Fire is also an issue on land, something that Earth seems to have gotten lucky with. And it's bad enough that it's to the point that even if you had a perfect analog of Homo sapiens walking around, ready to build a spacefaring civilization, you may be stopped dead in your tracks by this. Fire is very situational and may not be harnessable at all on a majority of exoplanets, even if they have oxygen. Oxygen is the key player here. There was a time on Earth where fire wasn't possible, and a further reality is that Earth is the only known planet that actually has combustion. It's worth noting here that some things, such as the Sun, are sometimes likened to being on fire, but it's not. It's its own thing. Nor is molten lava on fire in this way. It's just unbelievably hot. So you can most definitely have heat without the need for a chemical fire in an oxygen environment, but not combustion. Most heat, in fact, is not created by fire. None of the other planets generate heat that way. And it may actually be that Earth is a very special, very specific case that not only may be very rare for exoplanets, but bordering on nearly impossible. So the first issue is Earth's oxygen. It's only here because of life, and it took an immense amount of geologic time for photosynthesis to reach the levels of oxygen Earth enjoys. So fire as we harnessed it actually required life in order to be possible at all. That's where this starts looking like a Fermi Paradox solution. But by the time sufficient oxygen was released into the atmosphere, it was still a time where all life on Earth, so far as we know, was confined to the ocean. And on land, there was simply nothing that could meaningfully combust in the needed way. Essentially, life is fuel for the fire. Not very many things in nature other than life that you'll find on land on a planet are readily combustible. The products of life, however, can be readily combustible, such as wood. For Earth, life on land simply had to expand and colonize land in a flammable form. The first evidence for fires on Earth are from just 420 million years ago, meaning that for the vast majority of the history of the Earth, its full first 4 billion years, there was no fire. And even the beginnings of life on land weren't really conducive for fire. The proverbial elephant in the room, however, involves one of Earth's strangest life forms to have ever existed. Known as prototaxites, this genus of land life forms were extraordinarily important in several ways. First, they, and species like them, were what was responsible for creating the first soil. But they also may have been the first things to ever catch fire. The prototaxites were something like a fungus, analogous but not entirely like a mushroom. But there's still open debate as to whether they really can be classed as a fungus or not. Right now, they generally are, but these things can change. What we do know about it is that they were enormous. They could form a trunk as much as a meter wide and reach a height of 26 feet. And being biological in nature, they were flammable. And by being tall, they also attracted lightning, thus the advent of fire on Earth. So first you need life on a planet, not guaranteed. Then you need photosynthesis on a planet, also not guaranteed. Then you need life to move on land, again not guaranteed, nor is it a for sure proposition you even have land. And then you need that organism to have a way to catch on fire, and it gets worse. Relatively isolated giant fungus fires are fires indeed, but not quite what you need to get to Earth's level that produced us. There you need things like leaves to spread the fires, which came much later. Next comes the transformative Carboniferous period starting about 359 million years ago. This period was a nightmare of sorts. This was also the age of giant insects the size of large birds and oxygen levels up to 35%. Today it's 21%, you can see where this is going. Also wandering about were amphibians the size of Volkswagen beetles and the Dawn tadpole, which was 4 meters long. I'll take my comfy Holocene epoch over the Carboniferous, thank you, and that's another solution to the Fermi Paradox in and of itself. Someone stopped by here during this period, looked around, decided it was a nightmare planet, and told everyone else in the galaxy not to come here and hide from it because nothing good is going to evolve from that mess. So Earth at this stage had become what we'd call forested. The reason this period is known as the Carboniferous is because of carbon, and that references the fact that a huge amount of coal was being deposited on Earth. A lot of our global coal reserves are from this period, in fact. It's thought that decomposition was not quite in full swing yet. The microbes that break down plants efficiently today had not yet evolved. So lots of fuel laying around in a highly, insanely oxygenated atmosphere compared to what we have now, and lightning. This is a recipe for a fire world, as much as it is a land world and a water world. And were I around at this time, evolving back to the ocean would have been an attractive proposition. And the fires would have been bigger, more intense, and more frequent. This flirts with one side of the solution here, that you can actually have too much oxygen in a planetary atmosphere. Earth well hit this during the Carboniferous period. Any civilization that might develop but has to contend with very high oxygen levels and a very high susceptibility to fire is going to face the potential of getting frequently reset to the point that the march towards civilization might stagnate in the face of being so busy avoiding fire that you don't have time for it. It's possible that had human-level intelligence existed on land during the Carboniferous, it would not have hit civilization due to constant resets. Conversely, an oxygen world with less than 18% oxygen content in its atmosphere isn't going to support much combustion, even though it still has a lot of oxygen, which is yet another solution in its own right. If Earth is on the upper end of oxygen production by biology, we don't know if that's the case, then fire never happens. Or if the levels drop for some reason below that threshold, fire ceases. So the apparent combustion sweet spot for an exoplanet with a civilization is between 18 and 30%. Any higher, it gets very dangerous, and any lower, fire doesn't happen. And it's also worth noting that anything below 19.5% won't fully support the normal functions of the human brain. Though in fairness, we evolved in our 21% environment, and there may be other possibilities for intelligence. Here, fire really guided the evolution of plants, which in turn helped to guide the evolution of animal life. Fire was essential, and by the time of the end of the dinosaurs, trees like the pines, that required adaptations for fire to exist, as they do, were present. Some species of tree have to burn completely to even reproduce. There's plenty of evidence, actually charcoal, in the fossil record from the age of the dinosaurs to indicate that fire was common. But then something came that set much of the planet on fire, the asteroid that killed the dinosaurs. That one event changed evolutionary history in a major way, but Earth's life recovered, albeit moving in a different direction than it was in the Cretaceous, and one of those was in the development of grasses and grasslands. These would not have evolved without fire, and they carry some very severe implications in their own right, and might be some kind of a solution to the Fermi Paradox. The thing is, grasses are generally designed to burn. The roots survive it, and as they go dormant for the year, fire clears the land above and returns nutrients to the soil for the next period of growth. The thing is, it may be without the development of grasslands, which need fire, there may never have been Homo sapiens. And if we had arisen, one of the major contributing factors to the development of our technological civilization would not have been present. Most staple crops. Now some would have, in fairness. The potato, for example, was a major one in Peru, and that allowed for the formation of the Inca Empire, and it's not a grass. But other places not so much. For North America, it was corn that formed a major component of indigenous agriculture. Corn is a selectively bred prairie grass. Wheat in Europe is a grass, and all its variants, such as einkorn. Rice, the staple of Asia and parts of Africa, is a grass. It's very difficult to envision, and very murky to envision, our civilization of today having developed without those grains. And they were so integral to early agriculture that without them we'd definitely live in a very different world at least. But to get there we needed an asteroid, and the right evolutionary pathways to get to them. That may not happen on alien worlds, though in fairness this isn't a solution in its own right because we know nothing of what's possible in alien ecosystems and there may be other paths. Perhaps many paths to technological civilization on this count that just didn't happen here. They may not even have needed agriculture at all on the right planet, and the lack of many grass-based staples might not even have been a showstopper for humans. We may have tried to pursue others, though it would have radically changed the equation on what we could do with industrial livestock keeping and agriculture. But given all of the factors that had to align for Earth to be able to host combustion, versus what Earth was before it could host fire, along with how situational it was, and the fact that only us and the arson birds of Australia use fire as a tool, it seems somewhat unlikely that an exoplanet would allow for fire to begin with. They don't have to, but also develop species that can harness it, and then those species move on to technological civilization. Homo erectus did not, even with fire, they went extinct. So this solution to the Fermi Paradox is quite simple. If fire is needed for civilization, and fire is very rare and situational, then the universe teems with life, but only the fire planets can produce civilizations, and they are few and far between. But one must always caveat, and the big one here is that there may be ways aliens could build a civilization without fire. Different situations lead to different outcomes. One is using geothermal energy, basically volcano heat, to smelt metal. Still difficult to do in an ocean, a bit harder on land than fire, but possible, and volcanoes are not rare in the universe. There's also sunlight and mirrors to concentrate heat, but you still have to have a way to make a mirror. But by the same token, can natural visible light spectrum mirrors evolve? Plants did it with infrared, and it's unknown for visible light, it just didn't happen here. Another is that oxygen isn't the only oxidizer and path to combustion. Fluorine is even better. It just leads to fire as we know it, and if we look out into the cosmos with ever-increasing resolution, we may see evidence, such as the atmospheric oxygen conditions for fire on exoplanets, and conclude that it's not rare. It just seemed like it would be. That's interesting, though, because that would infer an analog of plant life, but also foliage. You need it to spread the fire. If you can detect that, then that allows you to understand an alien biosphere a little better than you normally would without going there. But fire itself would generally be hard to detect because its products are things like carbon dioxide, which occurs naturally. Where you might see it, however, is very short term. Where if you catch an exoplanet that just got hit by an asteroid like Earth was at the end of the Cretaceous, then a combination of a dramatic rise in CO2 from fire and a massive spike in methane from rotting life might be visible from a distance for a time, if you happen to catch it just after the event. Not likely, but possible. But also unusually revealing from an astrobiological context if it happened. But there's one last strange aspect of fire to make note of. Life needs fire, and fire needs life. Fire requires oxygen to exist. Life does not, but complex life like humans and our giant brains does. Fire grows, so do we. Fire requires fuel, so do we. Fire reproduces, so do we. Fire can be both destructive and created, as are we. The mutual bond between fire and life is very deep indeed. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned about nature again. So things sometimes repeat in the history of life on Earth. So what if the firehawks weren't the only species to figure out the starting wildfires trick? The giant carboniferous fire mosquito. I'll have none of that. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.